two nuclear-armed states, one river system, and a single sentence that still echoes across South Asia: blood and water cannot flow together. Those words, spoken by Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi, were not delivered on a battlefield. They were delivered in the context of water. And that is precisely what makes them unsettling. Because this story is not simply about diplomacy or borders or even ideology. It is about something more fundamental, something every society depends on, every civilization is built around, and every war ultimately returns to water. In the Indus River Basin, water is not a resource, it is a lifeline. And when lifelines are shared by rivals who possess nuclear weapons, the stakes rise beyond ordinary geopolitics. One neighbor lives upstairs and controls the main valve. The other lives downstairs and needs that water to survive. For 70 years, a piece of paper kept the peace. But today, the ink on that paper is fading. By April 2025, following the Pahalgam terror attack and the subsequent military standoff, it became a terrified reality. India announced it would hold the Indus Waters Treaty in abeyance. For the first time in history, the legal firewall between water and war was suspended. This is the story of how geography, engineering, colonial history, and climate change have combined to place India and Pakistan in a permanent state of hydropolitical tension. A conflict that has never fully erupted, yet has never truly been resolved. To understand why water became a strategic weapon in South Asia, we have to go back to 1947. That year, the British Empire carried out one of the fastest and most consequential withdrawals in modern history. In a matter of weeks, British India was partitioned into two new states, India and Pakistan. The boundary between them, known as the Radcliffe Line, was drawn by a British lawyer who had never been to India before and was given just over a month to divide a subcontinent. The line cut through villages, railway lines, irrigation canals, and most critically, through river systems that had evolved over thousands of years as unified ecological networks. Nowhere was this more consequential than in the Indus Basin. The Indus River system is one of the great river networks of the world. It begins in the Tibetan Plateau, flows through the Himalayas, and spreads into a vast agricultural plain before emptying into the Arabian Sea. For millennia, civilizations rose and fell along its banks. But in 1947, this basin was split in a way that defied hydrological logic. When the borders of India and Pakistan were drawn, the princely state of Jammu and Kashmir was deliberately left unresolved. Unlike provinces directly ruled by the British, Kashmir was a semi-autonomous princely state, governed by a local monarch under British paramountcy. With the end of colonial rule, these princely states were not automatically absorbed into either new country. Instead, they were formally given the legal right to accede to India or Pakistan, or at least in theory, to remain independent. In the case of Jammu and Kashmir, this legal framework collided with political reality. The region's population was overwhelmingly Muslim, particularly in the Kashmir Valley and the western districts, and many among this majority expected accession to Pakistan, with which they shared religious, cultural, and economic ties. Others, including several local political leaders, argued for a plebiscite, a popular vote that would allow the people of Kashmir themselves to determine the region's future. This position reflected both the demographic reality of the state and the growing demand for political representation among its Muslim majority. The ruler of the state, Maharaja Hari Singh, did not share this vision. A Hindu monarch governing a Muslim-majority territory, he was wary not only of accession to Pakistan or India, but also of any process that would weaken his own authority. Rather than endorsing accession or a popular referendum, he attempted to postpone the decision entirely, hoping to preserve Kashmir's autonomy under his rule and extract favorable guarantees from both sides. But this political limbo proved unsustainable. As internal unrest spread, state authority weakened, and armed groups entered the territory in late 1947, the theoretical promise of a referendum collapsed under the pressure of violence and fear. The question of accession, once framed as a legal choice, was rapidly overtaken by events on the ground and transformed into a military emergency. What followed was the first India-Pakistan War. By the time a UN-brokered ceasefire took effect in 1949, Kashmir had been physically divided. India took control of roughly two-thirds of the territory, including most of the mountainous upstream regions where the Indus, Jhelum, and Chenab rivers rise. Pakistan retained control of the lower western portion, where these rivers flow onward into the plains. This division would prove decisive. Most of the river's headwaters now lay on the Indian-controlled side of the new frontier, but the vast agricultural heartland that depended on that water, the canals, farms, and food systems painstakingly built under British rule, ended up largely in Pakistan. In other words, Pakistan inherited the fields, but India inherited the taps. And for Pakistan, this imbalance carried a deeper, more unsettling meaning. In April 1948, just months after partition, and while the first India-Pakistan war over Kashmir was still ongoing, India temporarily stopped water flowing through canals into Pakistan from the eastern rivers. Although the stoppage was short-lived and later resolved through negotiations, it occurred at a moment of extreme political uncertainty, before any water-sharing framework existed, and while Kashmir's status remained violently contested. Its impact went far beyond the immediate disruption. For Pakistan, the episode became a formative lesson. Upstream control could translate into downstream pressure. Even if the water eventually flowed again, the precedent had been set. Water, in this new geopolitical reality, could no longer be assumed. It had to be secured. For more than a decade, India and Pakistan struggled to find a solution. Bilateral talks went nowhere. Distrust hardened. Each side accused the other of bad faith. The fear was that water disputes could become a permanent trigger for conflict. Then, in 1960, something remarkable happened. With the World Bank acting as a broker, India and Pakistan signed the Indus Waters Treaty, one of the most ambitious and detailed water-sharing agreements ever created. The logic of the treaty was radical in its simplicity. Instead of sharing every river, the basin itself was divided. The three eastern rivers, the Ravi, the Bees, and the Sutlej, were allocated to India. The three western rivers, the Indus, the Jhelum, and the Chenab, were allocated to Pakistan. This arrangement gave Pakistan control over about 80% of the basin's total water volume, even though India controlled most of the upstream territory. In return, India retained limited rights over the western rivers. It could use them for non-consumptive purposes such as hydropower, irrigation of small areas, and domestic use, but it could not store large quantities of water or divert flows in ways that would reduce supply to Pakistan. For decades, the treaty was hailed as the gold standard of water diplomacy. It survived the wars of 1965, 1971, and even the 1999 Kargil conflict. While tanks crossed borders and jets filled the skies, water continued to flow. But treaties do not exist in a vacuum. They exist inside political realities. And over time, those realities began to shift. The core of today's conflict does not lie in dams alone. It lies in engineering details that most people never hear about, but which carry enormous strategic weight. At the center of the dispute is a concept called run-of-the-river hydropower. On paper, this sounds benign. Unlike large storage dams, run-of-the-river projects are designed to generate electricity without significantly stopping or diverting water. Water is channeled through turbines and returned to the river downstream. India argues that these projects fully comply with the Indus Waters Treaty. They generate renewable energy. They do not permanently store water. They do not reduce long-term flows into Pakistan. From India's perspective, this is a legitimate use of its treaty rights, especially in a region like Jammu and Kashmir, which faces energy shortages and economic underdevelopment. But Pakistan sees something else entirely, because even run-of-the-river projects require a degree of pondage, temporary storage of water to regulate flow through turbines. This storage may be small in volume, but it introduces something far more important than capacity. It introduces control. Pakistan's fear is not that India will steal the water forever. The fear is that India could manipulate timing. In an agricultural system, timing is everything. Crops depend on predictable flows during sowing seasons. Even short disruptions can cause significant losses. Pakistan argues that a series of upstream projects, each with its own pondage, could allow India to temporarily hold back water during critical periods or release it suddenly during monsoon seasons, increasing flood risks. Individually, each project may appear insignificant. Collectively, they create a system where upstream regulation becomes possible. This is why specific projects have become flashpoints. The Kishanganga Hydroelectric Project, built by India on a tributary of the Jhelum River, was one such case. Pakistan objected that the project diverted water away from the river's natural course, potentially reducing flows into Pakistan-administered Kashmir. The dispute went to international arbitration. The court allowed India to proceed, but imposed restrictions on how much water could be diverted and how much pondage could be maintained. But then came Ratle. The Ratle project on the Chenab River is massive, 850 megawatts. Pakistan views Ratle's design as a direct violation of the treaty. They argue the dam is too high, the pondage is too large, and the floodgates are too low, features that would give India the physical capability to stop the Chenab's flow for days. For years, this dispute dragged through slow-moving legal channels. Then, in the mid-2000s, the patience snapped. In January 2023, and again in August 2024, India issued a formal notice to Pakistan. "We want to modify the treaty." India argued that the 1960 agreement did not account for modern engineering, changed geopolitical realities, or climate change. They wanted the freedom to build. Pakistan refused. To Islamabad, opening the treaty for renegotiation is like opening a Pandora's box. They believe India's superior size and upstream leverage would leave them with nothing. The diplomatic Cold War turned hot in April 2025. Following a deadly attack in Kashmir, which New Delhi blamed on Pakistan-based militants, the Indian government took the unprecedented step of declaring the Indus Waters Treaty in abeyance. While the World Bank's Court of Arbitration in The Hague issued rulings in June and August 2025 supporting Pakistan's technical objections regarding the dams, the reality on the ground had shifted. India simply refused to participate in the court proceedings, calling the tribunal illegal. Reports emerged from the border regions of reservoir flushing, sudden releases of sediment heavy water by Indian engineers. In Pakistan, this was interpreted as a test run. The gold standard treaty was no longer a shield, it was a relic. While the politicians argue over legal clauses and dam heights, a much more ruthless enemy is ignoring the borders entirely: climate change. The Indus Basin is one of the most vulnerable water systems on Earth. It depends heavily on glacial melt from the Himalayas and the Karakoram ranges. Right now, we are in a phase of accelerated melt. The glaciers are shrinking fast. In the short term, this actually means more water, flash floods that destroy infrastructure, as seen in the devastating Pakistan floods of 2022. But the long-term forecast is terrifying. Once the peak water moment passes, predicted to happen around 2050, the flows will drop off a cliff. The glaciers will be too small to feed the rivers during the hot, dry summer months. Simultaneously, the populations of both India and Pakistan are exploding. By 2050, the combined population of the subcontinent will exceed 2 billion. You have a shrinking pie and more mouths to feed. India needs the water to feed its growing cities and power its industrial rise. Pakistan needs the water to keep its population from starving. This is the Malthusian trap. When resources run out, rational actors start behaving irrationally. We stand today at a dangerous precipice. The engineers can pour concrete. They can build spillways and desilting chambers. They can calculate flow rates to the cubic meter. But there is one thing engineering cannot build: trust. With the treaty in abeyance and the diplomatic channels frozen, the buffer zone is gone. Every maintenance shutdown of a turbine in Kashmir is now viewed in Lahore as an act of war. Every flood in Punjab is viewed as an act of sabotage. As the glaciers melt and the rhetoric heats up, the world must ask: can two nuclear neighbors find a way to share a dying river? Or will the next great war in South Asia be fought not over land or ideology, but over a glass of water? Don't forget to subscribe to the channel so you don't miss new videos. See you in the next video.